Welcome back to the live virtual interviews at Star East. I'm joined with Bob Galen. Bob, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Owen. Thanks for having me.
Of course. Yeah, so Bob, we were chatting just before we went live here. Bob, you have three tutorials already at Star East, all three with Mary Thorne.
Yep, we partnered on all three.
Yeah, and you were talking about how you love partnering.
I think I started speaking years ago and was a lone ranger, and it worked well, and I got better at it. But what I found is it's you're always on, and there's always pressure, and you never get a break. And it's not the break, but you're not seeing the audience, and you're not reacting well. And then I started inviting, maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago, I started inviting partners in and pairing. And you need the right person, you know this, you probably need the right personality and the right interchange, so you can't pair with everyone. But Mary and I found a good niche, and it works. The feedback we get is people get a lot more value out of the two of us rather than the individuals. So yeah, we have fun with that.
Yeah, it's really cool. And Bob's an Agile coach. For those who don't know, Bob's an Agile coach, trainer, consultant, and you gave a lot of the three tutorials were all somewhat based on Agile testing.
Absolutely. So 10, 15 years ago, it was all waterfall. Mm-hmm. So I was Waterfall Bob, and now I've been converted somehow magically over the years into Agile Bob. So that's where my passion is. Now the waterfall experience helps me because in a lot of people, they're not all in Agile, like friendly Agile context in the classes, you know that. Mm. So it helps to have the context of you've been in their place and you know what waterfall's like and the challenges are, and then you know what good Agile looks like and you can sort of paint that picture for them. So I think that helps, but yeah, they were all Agile centric.
Right, and one of them really caught my attention was the test leadership in Agile teams.
Yep.
I was interested, why is it so important to have a good test leader or test management structure inside of your Agile teams?
I'm going to generalize it, and I did this in the class. It's mm-hmm. Let's not talk about test management or test leadership. Let's just say leadership.
Okay.
I think Agile contexts need really solid leaders. Now, in an organization, you have software leaders, you have BA leaders, you have test leaders, or managers. Very often it's managers. So what we need, I think part of the transformation, and that's what we were talking about in the class, is you want to move from a tactical management view, to what I would think of as a strategic leadership view. And then I want test leaders, so I want managers to become leaders, and we want to maximize everyone. So I don't want you to just be a siloed leader. Like, you're not... I looked at the audience yesterday and I'm like, you're no longer, so I promote you. You are an Agile leader in an Agile context. You are no longer just the leader of this silo. You can actually lead developers. You can lead BAs. You are a leader in an Agile context of Scrum teams, etc. And you have to stop thinking of yourself as a silo or a hierarchy. And you have to think of yourself, I'm leading the organization. And you're not managing the details. So part of that transformation is trust the people. They got the tactics, right? They got the details, but what are you providing? Mission, vision, interference for them, making sure that they have what they need to do their job, et cetera. Planning, forecasting ahead. I know Covaris does a great job. I mean, you guys are not you live in the moment, but you also have to look into the future and say, right, where is the industry going? And the leadership team there has to do that. So we were talking about it making that change of looking beyond your silo, shifting from management tactical to leader strategic, providing the vision, not solely doing everything, but trust. So trust came up, like trust your team, etc. I think folks were struggling with it in the room in general because there was a lot of tactical waterfall folks there who were in their silos. There was not a lot of Agile context. But I think as we went through the workshop, I think we were getting some ahas. And I was sort of, we were bursting the status quo a little bit, I think, in there. So it would be interesting. I would love to be able to follow those people back to their offices and see if we've inspired them to change a little bit. I hope we have.
Yeah, I mean, that's really great. I am relatively new to Agile processes. And our leadership, like you mentioned, at Covaris, has been working with me and my team. And one of the things, and the way they kind of framed it for me is, kind of the agile leader there, like you said, is there for the vision and kind of playing a blocker. And they framed it to me as that's the what. They're gonna let you know what the what is. Yep. You have to deliver the how.
Yeah.
You know, how is your team going to come together and organize in a way that allows you to deliver at a high rate and a high quality product to your customer?
Yep.
And that was really kind of eye opening to me. When you have kind of new teams coming in, you know, what are some initial steps that you know new leaders, these agile managers or agile leaders can take when they're first kind of transitioning from waterfall to agile. I know a lot of people have already made that transition, but like you said, there's still people that are in waterfall right now.
So one of the things we talked about, there was a lot of bad agile in the room yesterday, if you know what I mean. Like, like folks were doing Scrum, but when you peel the onion, they're like only having a stand-up or something. And then they're wondering, well, the Scrum isn't working. And they're beginning teams. And the analogy I try to use is like teaching, you know, 8 to 10 year olds baseball. You're not going to like give them a rule book and then throw them in a field. And I mean, I've seen kids do this and they start running around the bases, they steal the bases, they start running around backwards, they start throwing bats at each other. They need rules, right? They need a little bit of control. And a lot of times these folks go from command and control. Either they make two mistakes, sometimes at the same time, they either don't give them any advice or any constraints or any control. And so it's we're going agile, but it's agile like the inmates are running the asylum, or they're doing too much control. And the teams are really, they haven't changed anything. They're just acting the way they have. So we talked a lot about, I think, good Scrum. Or it's not Scrum, it's whatever you're going to do. It's not about going through the tactics, it's about getting that mindset. For example, trust. Mm-hmm. It's not, the leader needs to trust the team, but they also need to inspire the team to trust one another. For example, developers and testers in traditional waterfall teams, high trust, low trust. What do you think? I'd say low.
Yeah.
I'd say low. We're throwing it over the wall.
Right.
Right. Trust but verify.
Right.
Testers don't trust developers. They can't test their own code.
Right.
Right. Developers don't trust testers. They can't. My stuff is too complex for them to test. So that leader has to make a shift. They have to do two things in that shift to really get it going well. They have to shift their mindset and trust the team, but they also have to provide guidance to give the team space and encourage or coach the team to trust each other, to create, sort of change their behavior, but change the team's behavior.
Right.
So that's sort of part of that. I think we gave them a lot of hints around, I would couch that as new teams come in there as a leader and demand like the agile mindset. Quality first, for example. Mm-hmm. Don't drive with speed. Speed is important, but delivering crappy stuff that the customer doesn't want really quickly doesn't count so much.
Right.
So you want speed, but it's like, get that balance right. That resonated in the room. Now, not the odd thing, but the interesting thing is a lot of times leaders are looking up and saying, oh, I get it, I'm on board. But it's not happening that way. I want those folks up there to fix it for me. Mm-hmm. So we were also trying to put the monkey on, if you're a leader, that means you have to be the change. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, you have to. And it's like, I want them to change everything, right? No, yes, you need their help, but you can't just wait for them. You're a leader. You have to instigate the change yourself.
Right, yeah, absolutely. And I think taking the initiative, and I think that's a great first step, is putting the trust on the team and saying, you know, I do value it and think you can do a good job, and that's why we've employed you here.
Exactly.
And that's the thing, we're paying you money to do this.
Yep.
We have to trust you to be able to do your job. And there's a great quote by Steve Jobs that I love that says, I don't hire smart people to tell them what to do.
Exactly.
I hire smart people so they can tell me what to
do. Exactly. And that's the point. And give them, and again, it's leadership. Give them the space. The other thing we talked about, though, if the team asks for help, then help them.
Right.
Right? But don't muddy the waters. If they don't ask for help, they're probably good. Mm-hmm. Give them that space to be sort of, to give them the mission, give them a vision, give them measures, give them metrics. But give them, why are we doing things? We talked a lot about the why. Mm-hmm. Why are we doing things? What are the goals? What does success look like? But then the individual tactics of how we get there, sort of let that sort of explore with the team. The other thing is there's a lot of silos. I'm going to be giving a lightning keynote today, and I'm going to talk about language and silos. I think we have to, it's surprising to me, it's 2019, and the language in the room was still them and us. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I heard so much, I had to listen for it, but I heard so much them and us, meaning silos. Even from the Agile folks who said, we're doing Agile, I heard like this them and us, and we're good and they suck, right? Or something like that, right? And it's sort of adversarial, and we need to break those barriers down. We need to start, it starts to shifting to we. It's team and we, and not pointing fingers, but really looking at the goal that we have, right?
Right, so. Yeah, I had a conversation yesterday with another speaker, and we were talking kind of about that siloed idea that even in Agile teams, that still, I mean, you still see that happening. We're talking, maybe that's bad Agile. And we were talking about kind of the job title as part of maybe the blocker in getting there. And he was like, you know, what if we just all have the same job title?
I know. Well, that's the thing. Or even in our head switch it.
Right.
I mean, I don't think we're ever going to get rid of like org charts and
right.
job title. I mean, money matters, right?
Yes,
and all hierarchy matters. But if we could erase that, like put it on a wall and then disconnect it from our brains. So that's like payment. And then this is the real world execution. But we muddy the two too much. And the insidious thing is it affects our behavior, right? We're not working as a team. Mm-hmm. We're not un-team, but we're just not thinking as a team. I don't think folks in the room were really cognizant of that. I mean, they were using that language, but I don't think they're cognizant of what, like how damaging that can be to teamwork and flow and throughput and things like that.
Right, yeah, and it's even a little bit self-damaging almost when you're, you know, like I'm a tester and I was reading an article the other day and stop, you know, I always tell people I'm non-technical. And they said, stop doing that because yeah, you're non-technical, but you have different skills that bring value to the team.
So language, and I only have 5 minutes on the lightning keynote, but words matter. Right, and they're sort of self-fulfilling, and it's really like if we it's them and us. If we use the term like developer, like we articulate, I am a developer, I am a tester. That's not really good language sometimes. That's implying silos, right?
Right.
What if we change that? Well, I'm a team member, and my goal is to try to get stuff done with
right.
the other folks. I think that just that language changes the dynamic.
Yeah, so. Definitely. And on my team right now, we're working in, you know, it's, a lot of people still trying to take ownership in the work, which I completely appreciate.
Yep.
They're saying, I had to get this done. Well, really the team needs to get that done.
Exactly.
We need to come together.
And not be afraid to ask someone else, I
yes.
need help. Or I want to go home and see my son's baseball game.
Right.
Can you cover? Yeah, of course I can cover. We're a team, for God's
right.
sakes, right? Absolutely.
Yeah.
So really, that's actually Agile to me. What we're talking about is much more important in Agile than whether it's Scrum or Kanban. The tactics don't matter. This attitude and posture and sort of cohesion and collaboration and mutual respect, trust, that's what gets you good results, I
right.
think. Yeah,
yeah, and I think putting the people kind of at the front
yep.
of that transition is so important. And I think that as teams, you know, start to trust each other more and,
yep.
and start to kind of buy into this is the way that we should be doing things, that it just becomes easier and easier and you're able to deliver much better quality products.
Absolutely. Back to your original question, I don't think teams need leaders.
Okay.
So I don't, if you threw a team in a room, gave them, back to my silly baseball analogy, and give them the rule books and things and say, be agile, and then all of the managers, leaders left, I don't think you're gonna get what we're talking about. I think leaders have to help the team with that shift.
Okay.
Let's call it coaching.
Mm-hmm.
Let's call it in one-on-ones, in conversations. I think the team needs, so there is, I think there's a place for leadership in Agile teams and Agile organizations, I like a strong place.
Mm-hmm.
They're not the doing, but they're helping guide this team towards what does good look like? How are we gonna, we behave this way, how do we change that?
Right.
And that's what I want the leaders to do. So don't count test cases or how many automated test cases have we run per second. That's all nice, but how are we evolving the team?
Right, definitely. Bob, well, I really appreciate your time today. A great conversation, a lot of stuff that I'm going to try to bring back to my team and hopefully start to instill that trust in.
My pleasure. Thank you for having
fantastic.
Me.
Yeah, of course.
Really
Thanks,
appreciate
Bob.
It.